and he's the CEO of SigniaGlobe Financial. He has gained a lot of experience, having been at CIBC, First Caribbean International. He was a bank manager there, a regional sales and service manager, and he was involved in many projects. He is the holder of a bachelor's degree in public sector management, a master of science in project management and evaluation, and he's also a part-time lecturer and tutor in business strategy and policy at the Cave Hill School of Business. Now, George Thomas is no stranger to many of you who are into innovation and technology. He's a seasoned entrepreneur, and he's a pioneering banking technologist. And he's got over 20 years experience at the executive level. He is now the Deputy Chief Information Officer at the CIBC First Caribbean, where he has oversight over the bank's digital transformation strategy, enterprise architecture, delivery of digital and data science services. And he is involved from, I would say, from the womb to the tomb when it comes to making sure that digitalization project is successful at that bank. And then I have Colin Daniel. Now, Colin is a dear friend, and I also know him to be the principal consultant of Strategic Consultant Inc. and Advisory Services. He provides business solutions to his clients, including pricing and cost of goods and services, to deliver business profitability, business strategy consulting, succession planning, and organization planning. And you're probably wondering why I'm going to such detail to give you the bios for our panelists, so that you know that those who speak to you are well qualified and experienced to do so. So I will open the baton first by asking Mr. Paul Ashby a few questions. And during the session, please, ladies and gentlemen, note that you can pose your questions, because we've deliberately designed it to be interactive. We don't have any PowerPoint presentations because we have invited the public as well, not just our domestic finance institutions. And we want to make sure that you go away from this with more insight into what's being done and what can be done, and have your questions answered as well. So, Paul, I'm going to start by you by asking, what did your organization have to put in place to prepare to operate during the lockdown period?
Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much, Cyralene. Good morning to all my fellow panelists. Good morning to the organizers, and good morning to those persons listening. Yeah, so this whole period, the last 18 months, has been quite an interesting journey for us as a business. I think in January last year, we were, as a company, just sort of getting our hands around our merger, Signia and Globe, which became Signia Globe. And we really were excited about 2020 and marching on. First 3 months, excellent, doing very well. And then in end of March into April, we were faced with a whole different situation of a country that's locked down. In our environment, we really had most of our employees who were using desktops. So from a technology and from an equipment perspective, everyone, as I said, the vast majority of persons were locked to their desks. So essentially, the first thing we had to do was figure out a situation where how we could function in a situation where people were now having to work from home. And now, this is not only a technology equipment, this is also the idea of processes and the idea of transformation of people. So we immediately had to change processes. We had to change mindsets. We had to change leadership mindsets, the whole notion of people working from home. And so in our first instance, we tried to determine how we could do bare minimal services working from home. How we essentially, it was a business continuity sort of approach. As the year progressed, we realized that this needed to become more of an entrenched approach, where we had to do this as a way of life, because now you have the compounding issues of family and people having to be home of necessity because children and so on. So essentially, we had to move from a situation of business continuity to active business involvement. So there was the whole desire or the whole need to acquire more equipment, to change more processes, and to potentially become more equipped service customers pretty much from anywhere that we could, because the customer need still existed, and that was what was important. Although there was a lockdown and although we had restrictions, people still had financial needs. And we as a business had to realize that and become up to speed to service.
Uh, I want to also ask you, with respect to that, have you found that you found ways to improve your customer service during this period?
Well, I think we have indeed. So one of the things that was really like this really transformed us, it forced us to get to this point. So as an example, some of my lenders now, they don't actually see a client until, first of all, they absolutely need to until the very end. So most of the transaction really takes place online. So all the exchange of documentation and information. I think that's actually done well for two things. One, I believe it gets us a speedier end to the transaction, but it also allows the employer to manage themselves better because they don't have to archive time for an interview per se, right? So they can gather all the documentation and then they could do an online interview at a more convenient time rather than all the lost time of somebody coming to wait in the lobby and so on. So I think it's made us more efficient in how we could turn around a transaction. And it's also, I think, for the client as well in terms of providing information. So sometimes you have a client coming back and forth many times bringing information. Having to do it sort of in an online fashion, they gather everything, they send one email and it's there to you. So I think it is, we have been forced to become more efficient. I believe that is how business in many ways for us on the business side and for the customer on the convenience side.
All right, and George, you know, I want to ask you that question. What has the experience been at CIBC First Caribbean with respect to having to now provide more services online? I particularly want to ask, how have you found it when it comes to our seniors? Because we are always concerned about digital inclusion as well.
So, thank you and good morning. Thank you, Cyralene. Good morning, Cyralene, fellow panelists and participants. Welcome. So let me just kind of take a step back. We experienced a lot of what, or maybe very similar to what Paul described in terms of having to deal with working from home. So as I'm dealing with the customer point, you have to get the people in position. So we are spread across 16 countries. So really we had to rethink and retool to support our staff to be able to function appropriately from home. And then very cautiously, as the conditions varied in various places, allow customer support persons to come back out, right? So from a customer service perspective, digitally, what we saw was a significant uptick in the use of digital services after April. Starting April of last year, and it has not decreased, it has multiplied, right? So whereas before we saw, and I say this, I was the leader of the implementation for the first internet banking back in 2004. And over the years, we saw gradual increases. It was, you know, interesting numbers, but they went through the roof after COVID. So what we had to do technically was really expand capacity. And while we expand capacity, we had to become even more vigilant. We were always very vigilant from a cybersecurity perspective, but we had to really scale that vigilance up, enhanced our reporting or alerting, the use of things like artificial intelligence to be able to see different patterns of behavior and so on. So that's at a baseline. So we had to take care of our employees so that they could function. And in terms of working with our customers, we had to expand our digital services. And coincidentally, at the same time, we were rolling out something called digital client onboarding, which we've listened to our customers over the years on the pain points of opening bank accounts and loans and such. And we embarked upon a digital client onboarding program, which we had started rolling out right at the beginning of the pandemic. So we had to accelerate that. And what that does is it reduces the friction points, the number of times a person would have to come to a branch to open an account. And you can upload all of your information in one tranche, and then you have to make one visit where it's just eyes on. And just watch that space. We're doing even more things in the future to make it easier and less painful or more pleasant, let me just say, for the customer. Now, in terms of the elder population, all I will say is that, again, you'll be surprised, lots of the elder population are very tech savvy and have adopted our online capabilities. We still do see, and this is something that we have to continue working on, the traffic in the branch, but we have also rolled out more ATMs, right? We've rolled out smart ATMs that will allow persons to have greater facility, greater access to their funds. So if you're not into transfers of cash and so on, then everybody across the age and socioeconomic demographics use ATMs. So those are some of the things that we did put in place to address the emerging concerns and stay apace with the situation.
Thanks, George. But we may have some persons who are saying, yes, we understand that you've provided additional services online, but we're hearing so much of scamming. There's hammers of so many people who are stealing another person's identity theft, and persons who, because there's no face-to-face contact, it may be that they may feel more insecure using online services. Can you just allude to, I know you're techie, but can you allude to, so we could appreciate what there is in place that would give our consumers in Barbados comfort in using online platforms?
So there are a couple of things though. Again, let me kind of step back. We are analog people. We've grown up, most of us, of course, the Zennials and the Millennials are a bit different, but we talk of the older population have grown up in an analog without digital. So we know how to look left, look right when we cross the street, lock doors, this, that. The same kinds of mindsets apply for the digital space. You don't share your password. There's some basic awareness programs that we have been doing with our staff and with our customers alike to raise the level of awareness. Hygiene isn't the right word, but let me just stick with awareness so that you are more aware of where you are in cyberspace and how to protect your cards, your passwords, how to set stronger passwords, how not to be phished, because we will, as a bank, we will not send you communiques with attachments that you have to, you know, because that's how you get phished. You know, you click on something in an email and you get phished. And also from a technical perspective, our online edifices, if you will, online mechanisms have something called two-factor authentication. What that means, you have a password, but we will also send you we will also send you a token with a number that you would have to enter. You'll get a phone call when you're performing certain transactions, and a voice will tell you enter this number, so that as you add a beneficiary to make a payment or a bill payment or such, not a bill payment but a payment, you will have to enter a code. Those kinds of things we do to be able to raise the bar on security. So even if someone had your password, they wouldn't have your phone, they may not have your phone, or they wouldn't have access to your email. So there's multiple ways, there are several levels in which you access. I know in terms of scamming and so on, the cards, EMV cards are much harder with the chip cards. The bar is raised. And also on the ATM, there's anti-skim devices that we put that most of the banks have upgraded their ATMs to. And I'll say this: cybersecurity is a constantly evolving thing, because the human mind is so beautiful. Just as we innovate, the persons who take the other path in life to hack and so on, they also innovate. So we have to be constantly thinking of risk management, risk control. So I hope that answers the question in as non-technical a way as I can possibly muster.
Well, I certainly understood it, and I'm not a techie. And so, but I would like to have invite Colin now to give your perspective and how you've seen technology impacting the financial services delivery. And I'm going to challenge you, do you think we've gone far enough and can we go further?
Thank you, Cyralene. Good morning to everyone, to my fellow panelists and the participants. I'm going to come at this a little bit more differently. It has been a great experience to see the banks catch up with the rest of the Northern Hemisphere, Northwestern Hemisphere. Some of the things that we've seen put in place over the last 12 months have been available in other jurisdictions as early as 1998 in Canada, and as early as 2003 in another jurisdiction where I worked. So it's great to be able to do online payments. It's been great to do the remote work. I come from my environment where I manage teams across three or four jurisdictions in one of the territories I work with. So being able to work from home has not been a challenge. But what has been a challenge in this environment in 13 years of being back home has been still the reliance on paper. Some of the institutions, I will say CIBC, has gone a lot further than others, is we're still doing paper, we're still managing paper. So even if said we're using electronic means, Paul made a comment with regards, well, you're emailing the documents up to him rather than uploading, as George mentioned, into their portals. We need to get to a point where the amount of paper that's handled to do a remote transaction is not the same level that we have to do when we do an in-person transaction. So that's where I would like to see us transition to truly a digital approach to doing business. I know we mentioned a while back, there are the things of electronic signatures. That act hasn't been in place, I think, since 1999, but we need to move the whole country forward in terms of digitalization. So it is pointless to have a financial institution saying we will accept this, and then we still have a situation where I'm going to pick up my attorneys. They're saying we still need to see original documents. We have to move everyone into the digital space at the same pace. We cannot have a situation where you've said this must be digitized, we're digitizing this, but a staff member says, you can say what you like, but the client needs to come in and do what I want them to do. So we have to change the culture, but we also have to keep the technology fresh and up to date to where it is in the source market of our traditional Canadian banks. So being 20 years late to the market, fantastic, we're there, but we should not be 20 years late.
But Colin, one of the lovely things that I think COVID has done for us is that it allows us to leapfrog. So although it would be two decades late, I have been told that COVID in 1 year, 2020, it caused us to advance 10 years into where we need to be. So there's hope for us here. But what I hear you saying underlying is that we need to digitalize the economy as a whole. Am I hearing you correct?
You're very correct. So for example, one of the leaders in digitalization in Barbados has been the Barbados Revenue Authority. Believe it or not, I remember speaking to a former commissioner when they rolled out e-tax in 2008. And she said the challenge that they had were with the constant crashing of the e-tax system at the time was the pace of acceptance. So when they planned it along the similar lines of when e-tax filing was rolled out in Canada and the US, which had about 10 to 15% uptake. When that was done in Barbados, the uptake was over 50%. So I don't think there's a reluctance of Barbadians to use technology. In fact, they embrace it. We don't like being standing in lines. That's one thing that all of us hate, of having to go and stand in lines to do basic transactions. The Barbados government, I have to say this, over the last 12 months, they have embraced the effort to digitize the economy. They have made the best of a bad situation. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the BEST program for the hospitality industry, but one of the components in that program of what the Barbados government is funded is in fact encouraging the participants to use digital solutions, and they're funding those components as well in the program. So we need a private sector in this case to catch up with Barbados government. We need companies like Lime and Digicel to provide stable internet access, which means that when we do a call like this, we don't have to worry about the internet slowing up. We don't have to worry about transactions dropping. George, I think you're familiar with this. We need to make sure the whole framework works together seamlessly.
If you don't mind,
I would like to jump in as well, Manager.
Yeah. So you know, in terms of being behind the West and Asia and so on, let's take a positivistic look, if that's a word, a positivist look at this. What we've seen, what we're able to do is look at a wide range of use cases of the use of technology. We have Estonia, we have Sweden, we have the UK, of course, there's China, Singapore, the UAE, the Arab Emirates, USA, of course, Canada. And we can then, we have a buffet of choices. Now we are able, because we have been, as you say, behind, we can now see, cherry pick what works for our society, our culture, and then kind of be very intentional, because in a lot of those places it was innovators throwing things out there and the society responding and then regulations following behind. We can be a lot more structured, planned, and intentional about our digitization, so we can know, to the point made, Colin and Cyralene, over the past year you've seen the leaps forward. We can, but it's been kind of quickly planned, right? So we can continue to plan and be more intentional and thoughtful in how we digitize Barbadian society and indeed the Caribbean, the region, in a manner that fits with our culture. And similarly, there's certain changes in mindset and culture that we will have to make so that, again, so that the cybersecurity posture, the adoption of the technology and so on, and the ability to actually use technology in a way that's meaningful to our existence is realizable. So I would take a positive look at being a bit behind, being 20 years behind.
I understand that approach, but I wish we were 5 years behind rather than 20 years behind.
And I know that, don't worry, because you really have Colin at your heels. Colin, you have Paul at your heels, because Paul is eager to respond to what George and what you have said. Go ahead, Paul.
Well, I also want to bring you into it too, Cyralene, because you know, you work in the institution where I am going. So I think we have to have a standard platform on the understanding of the regulation, because we have number of regulators in the space and they all come at you with different requests and different understandings, and sometimes it's legislation or regulation versus practice and versus what people who have been in the system for a long time believe it ought to be. And I think if we had a standard platform of agreement, we would be better off, because there are different, of course, there are organizations will have policies, so we understand different organizations will have policies, but the issue is what is the acceptable thing in the marketplace for people to provide? So simple things like confirmation of address, and I guess the big one that Colin mentioned is the Wet Ink situation, where everything could happen online, but at some point in the equation, you need to see that person, you need to have that person sit in front of you, eyeball them, and you essentially need to have them put a wet signature down on some documents. So I do not believe that so we will have all the technology in the world in the sense of the system technology, but I believe that our regulatory practices and some of our processes, we will need to bring up to speed as well so that we can be as effective as possible.
And Paul, can I say this to you? You were going where I was going to take myself, being a part of a regulatory body, and saying when we say digitalization of the economy, the regulators have to step up as well. And I know the Electronic Transactions Act, you'd be amazed that sometimes persons, the word George says, we need a change in mindset and culture across Barbados, because I do think sometimes there's no need for somebody to appear in person. Yes, it is for us to make sure that we have the processes in place and to have a more centralized way of dealing with things. Actually, when I do have dialogue with some of our foreign regulators and some of the correspondent banks, etc., they kind of say that they wish that even throughout the Caribbean, there was a unified way of dealing with most things, because then they always have to do separate due diligence checks throughout each Caribbean island. So imagine even in Barbados, if we continue to have it where that every time you deal with a separate regulator, it's a new set of requirements. It does not facilitate business in a way with which we would want to. And I want to assure you, because there's no way I can recognize the problem because I am solutions oriented, to let you know, even at the FSC and the central bank, we are, especially in the AML space, constantly looking to see if we can put out a common guide into what is required. And it takes me to where I want to go. And I'm going to go there with you, Paul, and say, what have you had to do differently now from the regulatory perspective with respect to if you had to do any checks, AML checks on and verification on your customers? How have you had to adjust now that we've been forced to go more online?
Well, I don't think we've changed much. Of course, as Colin mentioned, you know, we get the information online, but we still do the same levels of due diligence. So all the work in the background remains the same. There are some tools that we can use, international tools, for example, like World Check and so on, that those are becoming more important and more, and in fact, we have to use them. But still, there are other things that you're required to do, which are, you know, still manual checks and so on. Verifications is the terminology that I would use there. So much has not changed. The back office work has remained pretty much the same. It's just the mechanism for getting the information and the mechanism for responding or reacting to the customer. Those things have probably sped up, but the actual crunching of the work in the back office is the same from my perspective.
Colin, do you think there's a better way we can do that, even when it comes to how we do our verification for AML and other purposes, from what you've seen in other jurisdictions?
So I was fortunate or unfortunately arrived in Bermuda a couple of weeks before 9/11. And life's changed in terms of post 9/11, in terms of rollout of KYC. But our approach in Bermuda was pretty straightforward. You had your service provider, and the requirement was that service provider, the first person to touch the customer, was responsible for doing the comprehensive due diligence. And once that was done, the other institutions like the banks or the SX or similar institutions were able to take that information from the service provider rather than go back to the customer. In Barbados, everyone that touches the customer comes with them, not only with the same requests, but in many cases, they want ABC, which has been provided to Paul. In addition, say CIBC wants DENF. So there needs to be a consistency in terms of the information that's required. We need to have maybe a centralized database or a centralized process. And that requires, as Paul said, cooperation among the regulators, as well as the institutions who are regulated. And with that clear understanding as to how the process works and who's responsible and what liabilities is accepted by being responsible, then I think we can get this process a lot more seamless. As a service provider, we are constantly explaining to potential customers what is required to do business in Barbados. And a lot of them step back and say, well, I don't need to do this. But in the background, in their jurisdiction, because they're an established client, they have not been familiar with what is going on in their own home space. So a couple of years ago, or a year ago, we were talking to a guy in Australia. And the pushback was, we don't need to do this. We don't do this in Australia. You go on the website of the Australian regulators and toss them in information. Yeah, by the way, you do need to do this. But because you may be in the front office, you don't know what the guys are in the back office are being required to do to get your client on board. But I think we as a jurisdiction need to make sure that our requirements are clear, and succinct, and easy to understand. I have seen situations where we're looking at doing a bank registration or insurance or fund registration, and we look on the checklist, and the checklist is comprehensive, and then we have this little statement or any other information we so require. Okay. If there's any other information you require, let us state it up front. Okay. Let us understand what the process is, and it has to be simplified. The chairman of the FSC spoke yesterday about being able to have an insurance company register within 72 hours. That was the standard in Cayman 10 years ago. A fund is licensed in Ireland and it came on within 3 days to get a preliminary license. Cyralene, we put it in a proposal to that extent that we need to follow that standard where you issue preliminary licenses and then you have 90 days to do the final certification. That is what we talk about doing, ease of doing business. We have this situation, I think my friend from the CIBC, George, would be familiar with the situation. We have the welcome stamp program, and we have people who have come into Barbados on the welcome stamp program who still cannot get bank accounts. So AML is something we have to find a way to digitize. We also have to be cognizant of the restrictions in certain jurisdictions that they do not provide you with a bank reference any longer. Okay, yes. So should that be on our checklist?
Yes, and Colin, I hear where you're going, and I'm going to ask George to come in a minute to talk to us about how Barbados is responding, because I think we are all recognizing that in some way we need to consolidate and centralize a lot of our information on our citizens. So when we have to do our vetting checks, but I must prompt you as a regulator to say that although before we would ask you for certain items, because we're doing risk-based regulation, Colin, there are some times where we may need to ask you for additional information. And I do take your point that we need to standardize where possible, but when we do look at risk, sometimes we may need, I know you would accept that, to ask for additional information. But George, can you, we understand and we've heard in the press about a digital ID that Barbados is working on. Do you have any information you could share with us about that at this time?
So what I would say is, I know that in the banking sector and the utilities and so on, the national digital ID is a way to provide an easier or government certified KYC of a person. So a lot of the friction points and things that Colin alluded to will be removed, because as an institution, you can subscribe to the national digital ID, you know, once it's operational, and there's not all the address verification, verification of the person and all that kind of stuff is now gone away. You add national credit bureau to that, and you see that the ability to open bank accounts, open any account with a utility, anything that needs your identity plus some background information on you becomes a lot smoother, right? At present, the institutions have to implement a lot of technology to remove the frictions, right? I mentioned the digital client onboarding that we released last year. Other institutions are doing similar things. With the national digital ID, it removes the need for all of that, and it becomes a lot easier to KYC, for KYC checks and ultimately AML. So I think there's a matter of inconsistency of application of the legislation. So Colin said 99, but it's actually 1998. I know this because I had to go to the central bank to say, we're going to do digital client onboarding. And by the way, we want to not have to store physical documents, and you had it on the books since 1998, so we don't want to invoke it, right? We did that about two years ago, and then we actually did a regional, we call it a road show. It ended up being a Zoom show because we went to one jurisdiction in January, and all the rest we had to do in this kind of format. But just suffice it to say that centralized government has been responding and moving in that direction to the national ID program, and we should be seeing it much easier to comply, because you can build into these technologies the rules that you need to follow. So it's not one institution doing one thing and another one doing the other. Anyone that subscribes to the digital ID will follow a set format, if you will.
Great, thank you. And I just want to take this a pause just to remind our participants that you can pose questions for our panelists in Slido. Please don't let them get away so easy by making the state that the customer service and that digitization have solved all woes. We want to, my next question, and you'll see where I'm going, is what else can we be doing, Colin? We've got technology at our fingertips. We can use it to improve customer service. First, Colin, and then Paul. Is there anything else that we can be doing, or that even at your institution, Paul, that you may be thinking about that you'd like to roll out, where we can use technology to better serve our financial customers? Colin, yeah. You first.
So I just want to make a quick point. Since the implementation of TAMIS, everyone has been, or almost everyone has been allocated a new tax ID number, which is actually a very strong indication of identification in Barbados. It's matched to your national ID number, it's matched to your, I think if I remember correctly, your NIS number. So there's a basis to do a search for a person to verify information there through that portal, and also through National Insurance Board. In terms of customer service, I think the things that we need to be able to do is certainly open new accounts. A point that George made, I believe, was, or yourself, in terms of the standardization of information across the Caribbean. As you well know, because of the lack of standardization and the issues of exchange control, we cannot do cross-border transactions. But if we are going to digitize, again, we have to digitize everything. It means that if I am a Barbadian and I want to do a trade on the Jamaica Stock Exchange, I should be able to use my platform in Barbados to buy securities in Jamaica or Trinidad, or even in Cayman or in North America. We need to, I think what has happened in terms of COVID is removing physical boundaries in terms of where we work, where we live. And it means that the financial institutions and the regulators need to be able to push those boundaries back as well, in terms of open up Barbados to the rest of the world. I know we're going to get some challenges in terms of concerns of foreign exchange and whatnot, but one of my things that I always say, if I have a foreign exchange problem, I need to find a way to earn foreign exchange, both in trade and services, and also the ability to do it on investment return through access to financial instruments. Certainly, we have to find a way to break the barriers down, because regardless of what we think, the barriers around the world are coming down around us. So digitization has to go to the next step to eliminate international borders.
Yes. Paul, anything you'd like to add?
Sure. So I think George raised a number of good points around the national ID, which I think is a matter that will have to get really good public relations promotion in our space, because I already see people coming up with a lot of conspiracy theories around that. But I think it's going to be very important for institutions like ourselves to be supportive of it and to basically make it happen so that it could be assistance to all. I think also the National Credit Bureau also is a good thing. And the next one is also the national payments processing approach, where you start to get a more inclusive banking capability for everyone, because there are a number of people now who will find it difficult to go into a bank to get a bank account. So you want to have people in the payment processing cycle. I think from our perspective as a company, we want to see an end-to-end processing and an end-to-end payment process. So end-to-end processing from loan origination or account origination to having the actual capability in your hand without necessarily having to come face-to-face with the institution. And similarly on the payments front, where you do not need to necessarily move from your living room, as was recently the case, where you couldn't necessarily move. So that is also a step for us, where you have the opportunity to make payments end-to-end for us. From our perspective, we are, our license does not permit us to a transaction type financial institution. We are part three institution, so we have to go through commercial banks. But even that in itself, the credit unions need to be able to be part of that process where payments can move smoothly across those institutions and at minimal cost, I would say.
Yeah.
So one thing I want to interject here, something that's actually happening right now. The ACH here is transitioning from batch to real time. And that is going to free up, and that is going to speed up the movement to digital payment space, because now you can look at having P2P type systems, pretty much like you have Zelle in the US, Pay8 in the UAE, and Swish in Sweden, you know, with a real time.
George, you're going to have to break that down for members of my audience. Yes, to explain ultimately how does that benefit the consumer.
Having a real-time ACH, for those not in the financial business, is the interbank connector, if you will. So it started off as a check processing mechanism, but as we evolve towards digital and away from checks, it is a mechanism by which monies can be within country. I'm not addressing the cross border because we know where that is. But within country, the ability for persons to digitally transfer funds to each other within country is enhanced. Today, I stand corrected. The ACH runs in two batches, maybe three. I don't remember. But when it's real time, it means that a different class of application can be developed, which then allow customers in the palm of their hand to say, look, let me enter, George wants to send Cyralene $50. I have her email address, or her mobile number. The application now can take that, and the real-time ACH now can adjudicate and say, okay, George is with FCIB, Cyralene is with, for Citizens, wherever, and move that money in, and you can have access to the funds in real time. Almost as though I was taking cash from my hand and handing it to you virtually, right? So that is there and occurring. The other thing that we're seeing in terms of financial inclusion, you're seeing EMV, the evolution of EMV-based prepaid cards, right? Which can then be walletized. Those kinds of things you're seeing on the horizon coming into being. So, like I said before, I'm very optimistic and excited at where we are poised and the things that are laid out in front of us.
All right. I know Colin will want to talk to me about the ACH system, but I have three questions here from our participants, and I will let you can take them, good gentlemen, as you who thinks they can best answer them. One of our participants has asked, who is ultimately responsible for driving the change as mentioned by Paul and Colin? Yes, is it the regulators, the financial institutions, or the customers?
I think it's collective, and it is collective because if our customer does not tell us, and I'm going to speak from a service provider's point of view, if a customer does not tell us what is needed, it is very difficult for a regulator or for a service provider to actually conceptualize a solution that is in demand compared to a solution that they think is required. So the customer itself should be engaged, constantly actively engaged in the process. The regulator also has a critical role. And I think one of our complaints in this marketplace is we tend to adopt the most stringent approach in regulation in Barbados, whereas in other jurisdictions, we look at what is the most practical approach that balances the risk off. And then the person who's actually caught in the middle in this case, and it'd be good to Paul and George in this case, is actually a financial institution. Because you have to deliver. you have to deliver to your two customers, which is your external customer who's paying your bills and to the customer who's regulating you. So it is a collective responsibility. So whenever we end up in a situation where something frustrates us, we need to speak up. And the people who are responsible for developing and implementing the solution have to be engaged and willing to listen to the customers.
All right. So I want to just stop at this, and I'm going to take it from the AML KYC regulatory standpoint. I think the financial institution and the regulator need to get together to have an understanding of acceptable risk, because we often take the, let's call it the international standard of what is expected, but there are different nuances in our country. There are a lot of things we understand about our space of, you know, how you know who people are and so on. And so there should be an understanding, and it's out there because you talked about it, right? You talked about escalation of risk and so on. So, but I'm not sure that's practice in its truest sense. So we need to have an understanding of what is acceptable in assessing risk, and then determine what are the things that are required to verify that a person says who they are and so on. Because some of the things that we now use are, it's like trying to shoot a fly with a gun, and I don't think that's necessary for environment.
So if I could add.
Go ahead, George.
Colin and Paul said, I mean, I think necessity, one thing the pandemic has done, necessity is the mother of invention. So, and ultimately the customer is king. So to Colin's point, the customer articulates a need, and the pandemic the need was a scream because it had to happen. So as a result, you'll see the responses. So typically, if you think Western, Silicon Valley and so on, you have these innovators, the Steve Jobs and so on, they go in their little woodsheds and they come up with things, and then they convince people to get them, right? And that they need them, and then they propagate. Or there's some circumstance, and sometimes it's war, right? That the internet was born out of war. The internet was a DARPA research project, so that in the case of a cataclysm, there's a distributed network, right? So most of the innovations we enjoy today came from conflict. So it's necessity, right? Where we are now, I think what you're going to see really is it's going to really be customers insisting, demanding, and to Colin's point, the financial institution keeping an eye on you, the regulator, petitioning to satisfy that need. That's why before any bank releases anything, we come to you and say, we intend to serve our customers in this way, based on what they've been telling us. Can you please give us the sign off on that? So we all have to work together, but the customer is the king. The customer is driving it.
Yeah, I think you've got it quite correct that the customer drives it, and the customer needs to know that we're listening. And probably we need to find more avenues to directly link with our customers to get their direct feedback, because you know they say that people often speak with their feet, meaning that they leave that particular service provider. But we don't want that. We want to find a way to engage. And one of the things Colin mentioned is we can also look, and you did too as well, George, we can look at other jurisdictions and see what the uptake of things were. We can learn from their failures, but we can also learn from their successes with respect to things that were offered to customers, and the appetite was there, so that we can make sure we roll those out so that we bridge that 20-year gap that Colin constantly reminds us of. But I have another question here, and I would like to ask it. There are two and they're similar, but I'll read them both. One is this for a panelist. How have you been dealing with customer mindset or apprehension about putting the personal information out there, not knowing exactly where it ends up, who is sharing it with whom, and not feeling confident that it is safe? And another person posed it this way. Digitalization of national IDs would be convenient, but poses significant cybersecurity issues. How do Barbadians trust in its security? So you see, we come back to that whole thing that persons are engaging, they're using the services, and they want to. So those are the two questions. One about the security issues, even around the proposed national ID. And then the second one is about when we share so much information on financial institutions, how do we know where it ends up? And we're not going to talk about the National Data Protection Act at this time, but just those, if you can respond to them, each panelist, please.
So from our perspective, we do see a lot of apprehension, particularly we do have a large elderly clientele. And so we see a lot of apprehension in persons even giving out their account number. So they feel, for example, you know, we would want to have your account number so we could send your funds directly to you. And we see a lot of apprehension there because, you know, an account number is a sacred thing for some people. And there's a notion that if they give you their account number, then you can have access to all their funds and so on. So I still think there's a large degree of education that needs to take place around the levels of security that financial institutions put in place to secure people's funds, secure their identity, secure their valuable possessions. So I think there's still some work to be done at the more mature end of our community. The younger demographic, they're fine. They put all of their information out there. I don't think they have any fears of that. They give it to you voluntarily. I think we more see the challenge in the elderly population. And George did make the point that people are becoming more savvy and more using technology. But I think when it comes to their money, they're a lot more guarded and don't necessarily want just anybody to have access to it. I know George is a lot more competent on talking about the cybersecurity space, and I would leave for him to tackle that aspect of it.
Yeah, thanks, Paul. Again, Paul said it, it's education and awareness. So each institution needs to have the continuous dialogue with the customer and demonstrably so. So for example, and I'm just speaking from an FCIB perspective, you know, we have invested so much in cyber and even in like using AI to look at patterns. So if your behavior changes and you get an alert, and I'm just going to do a PG version of a comment we saw online. They said, you know, FCIB is something else. You can't even go to the bathroom, but we don't want to send you an alert. I mean, we saw that on Instagram like a couple months ago. So it's that is demonstrable. And I think that some of our customers are beginning to realize that we are watching and we are monitoring, we are safeguarding. So it's communications, but also demonstrating the diligence and the hygiene that you're putting into keeping, into making, you're continuously improving the security. And I think that's what government is embarking on doing with the National ID program. That's the only way, one, continuously improve the cybersecurity practices in government, and also communicate that to the citizenry so that people over time, it's not something that's going to happen in a day or a month. If we use Sweden as an example, I think they are now 98 or 99% cashless, right? And that did not happen in a year. I remember I first became aware of them when I was working with the UAE, and the UAE was talking about going cashless, and I was looking at use cases, and I saw at that time they were like 95%. It took them another 5 years to get another 3 or 4%, and because in a lot of cases the elder population was it was taking its time, but you've got to give people time to get comfortable, and so we have to have bridging strategies while persons get comfortable with going digital. That's why cards are going to be around for another 10 or 15 years, right? If it was all millennials, we wouldn't even have cards today, right? It would be all digital, but we have to meet people where they are and help them along the journey. And we have to be patient and we have to provide support services required to help with that journey. And we have to continuously improve. You cannot just say, I've spent $10 million this year in cybersecurity and I'm done. No, every year you have to retrain yourself and constantly raise the bar. And we all have to do that because cybersecurity is a weakest link thing. So if a particular business, government person is has a lapse, it kind of affects the entire ecosystem. right?
Well, I don't know, Colin. George, thank you for that, and thanks, Paul. And Colin, I don't know if you want to respond, because you guys have touched a nerve because the questions are pouring in. So if you want to have a quick one to that, because I have a few other questions that have been posed to the panel. So go along. I give you a few seconds, Colin.
Very, very quickly, as a user, I feel much more comfortable with cybersecurity than writing my ID number on the back of my check that has my account number and my address and my telephone number. So I prefer to use a digital solution which can be encrypted rather than have a check folder roll with all of my personal information on it.
Great, and thanks. That's a good vote of confidence. But I underscore the education and awareness campaign that each of us have to among be it regulator, financial institution, government, we have to do it together. Here's a question. I am not familiar with this it's an app. It says, how do you see, I'm going to call it WIPAY, WIPAY, fits into this whole digitalization conversation? Are any of you three familiar with that?
WIPAY is a fintech. Yeah, WIPAY is a fintech. We're familiar with them. They're a very innovative fintech company, which is based out of Trinidad, and they entered here. I think they're funded by Republic Bank in Trinidad. They entered here, was it last year or year before? We know they're here, they're in some Eastern Caribbean countries and in Jamaica. And there's a cooperation between the banking system and the fintech companies, who obviously are small. I would say fintechs are like jet skis, whereas large banks are like aircraft carriers, right? You have institutions that are 100, 150 years old. And I sat on a panel once with the CEO of Cyralene, and he said, and he was a former colleague, and he said, listen, I don't have the institutional weight that George has, so I can do things that he can't. So there is a collaboration and cooperation between the institutions, and there's room for that, I would say. However, I mean, you're a regulator and the central bank here. So again, there is an interplay between your institutions and the fintechs of the world to ensure that we're all doing things how we're supposed to do them.
And thank you very much, George, because that leads us into another question we have here, which also we need to set the platform, because with the fintech companies, we also know we have the fat of obligations we need to meet when it comes to virtual asset service providers and cryptocurrencies and persons of that ilk. There's a question here, and this is a question for the panel. How do we balance our local regulatory peculiarities / nuances with the international regulatory demands that determine we are to be rated or controlled based on these set standards? Yes? So, and particularly to make sure that we are not blacklisted. And I see Paul smiling, because I think that's one for him.
Well, that's the point I was making earlier, that we do have these international obligations, but we do have local realities. And the point I was trying to make is, I don't think we adapt as well as we ought to, so that we take into account the nuances of our jurisdiction. I think sometimes we take wholesale what is being offered, but that my suggestion is for regulators and financiers to get around the table and see what is acceptable, what do we think is, you know, is a risk-based way of protecting the customer, and apply those things uniformly across our country. I think there's a way that we can do that easily.
And I am not a member of the panel, but I want to support you there, Paul, by indicating that we tend to do the national risk assessment. And our national risk assessment is generally for AML CFD purposes, where we gather the information from our financial institutions and our players in the sector. And it underscores the importance of information, statistics, and data, because it is that information that we need often when we have to go to present to our rating bodies, our assessors, to let them know Barbados is different, because when we look domestically, our data shows that this is not high risk, or this is a lower risk than even in your jurisdiction in which you operate. So it talks about that collaborative effort that is needed, that needs to continue between the regulators and the financial institutions and our populace with respect to participation in our national risk assessment, sending your timely filings so the regulator can have the evidence to show that how we rate ores is different. It may be lower, but it is justified. So I think you are correct that we need to have the dialogue, we need to do our risk assessments and share information so we can make an even more fortified case with respect to why or local factors need to have more weight so that we can have different applications of our AML, the AML guidelines as well that are set by
factors. Can I append something there as well? And it comes back again, customer confidence and so on. The adoption of standards like NIST, National Institute of Standards and Technology, right? They have frameworks, ISO 27001 and other internationally accepted frameworks or Data Protection Act, which contemplates GDPR, right? But GDPR directly affects us because as long as a European person is doing transactions here, we are liable to GDPR. You can't hide anywhere from that. As long as we focus on becoming compliant with these things, but with tailored to our particular context, we have to tailor them to our particular context. I think one, we in terms of going digital, I can't speak to other things. In terms of going digital, we align and we don't run the risk of being blacklisted as high risk from a digitization perspective. And concurrently, we have another means of communicating confidence to the citizenry that we are not just just throwing things together, but we're doing them in a thoughtful, mindful way that is aligned with internationally accepted standards that from NASA to European Space Council to JP Morgan Chase and all the major institutions comply to it.
International best practices. I have some questions here. Here's another one. And it says, I would like the panel. Go ahead.
I just want to interject here on this. And this is a topic that frustrates me because I saw in the period 2008 to about 2018, a number of international business companies roll up and leave Barbados because of the OECD EU approach. And we need to remind them as regulators and as participants in the financial sector, the Caribbean and Barbados represent less than 5% of the world GDP. We do not have direct access into correspondent banks. We do not have a correspondent bank infrastructure in place. So we need to constantly remind them that while you're looking at these regulations from a point of view of a much larger world, we are a micro piece of the issue and our regulations must reflect that in order to do business for our nationals and for our international customers.
And thanks for that, Colin. And I would say as one of the team that sometimes go to sit before these and haven't done it with my colleagues from the Central Bank and from the government of Barbados, we do make those cases. We do make those cases and we are vociferous with it. One of the things that we always like to do is have the data, have the statistics to support it, because trust me, we know that we are different in many areas, but there's some international things like George alluded to—that we still have to have the minimum standards that we meet. Here's a quick question from our colleague. It says, "I would like the panel, if they can, to allude to how safe our data is, even before we attempt to share. Many of us keep data in a very unsafe mode on mobile devices, laptops, online shopping mechanisms. I don't know why they're looking at me. Maybe our data is far safer when we share it with a bank as opposed to how we store it."
And I would say that comes back to the again the awareness and education. Cyber, we most of us are analog beings, even the Zennials and the Millennials, because people the kind of information that is shared online, I'm telling you there's a whole new dimension of hacking now that has to do with hacking your behaviors, right? The algorithms that will see all your chatter, they know your behaviors and so on, and they start to push things out to you based on your behaviors that nudge you into taking certain physical positions in the world, let me just put it that way. And we all know what, I'm not going to say it out loud, but we all know, we saw that on the global stage playing, we see it playing all the time, right? So it's about when we, if you put certain types of data on your mobile phone and you do not have the necessary protections on the phone, you know, prepare for something to happen, because you know, there are people who earn their keep by trying to find you and to relieve you of your information and sell it on the dark web, right? That's just how it is. I wouldn't say, I'm not the one to judge and say it's safer with the banks, but we are very thoughtful in what we do with, and we are regulated in how we treat data. And if we slip up, we are subject to fines and even going before the courts of law if we make certain mistakes, right? So we are very diligent in how we handle data. I would just say that the bar is very high for a banking institution and other regulated institutions, because you are watching us. You, Cyralene.
I was gonna make the point that there is a high threshold for that, and actually is a very high priority matter in our institution. I mean, this thing goes up to our audit committee, our board. Like, this is serious oversight, and we actually have cyber audits being taken place on a daily basis. There we have following practice emails coming to staff members to make sure that they do not click on things that they ought not to click on. So it's a daily check for us, just to keep ourselves in check and basically making sure that we are as safe as possible. As George said, is a net chasing it all the time, so you have to keep doing it. But cybersecurity clearly is a very important thing. We had an attack here locally within the last 12 months, and actually I discovered from that attack that there are several attacks going on all the time. That one got through. So we are actually quite vulnerable in this part of the world. So it's important to have it as a high priority item as part of your policies as an institution.
And to add to that, not only do we do those tests, but also every year, every employee has, and I believe it rolls up again to the regulator, has to take certain tests and pass. Absolutely. With a certain grade, and if not, it appears on your performance. It affects your performance, right? It affects your end of year gift, let us just say. If you're not compliant, everybody in a regulated environment has to pass these tests that works in that environment, whether it's a full-time or a contractor, in order to continue to be in good standing. So the bar is pretty high.
Right.
Great. Yeah. But I want to say to you that I have, using the cricket analogy, I have a fast bowler or two who are here on Slido. So one bowled me a ball about 10 minutes ago, and I'm going to put it here for the panel. I'm going to put it for the panel because the FSC is, I'm a moderator, not a panel member. It says, the regulators for banks, internal and external, have significantly higher cybersecurity requirements than the regulator for credit unions. Is there anything being done to bring the cybersecurity requirements for credit unions in line with those of banks?
So you know, since I am not a regulator, and I used to be a regulator, so that's how I know my place. I used to be on the Fair Trading Commission years ago, so I know my place. I can't answer that question because that's a regulator question. you guys regulate us, and we just do what you say. We can only beg for favor when our customers press us to do things.
But I think I'm a moderator, I will speak when it comes to the credit unions. I think across the board, because all of us are very familiar with hacking. I got so many times that even my basic Facebook, Hotmail, everything is hacked. And I think that's why it's a concern for most of our citizenry, because most of us have experienced somebody trying to get into some of our platforms that we use. I think the credit unions are also being challenged, and as a regulator for them, we're also challenging them to upend, to hype their own cybersecurity, because we know we have two large credit unions who are like small banks. And they themselves are very heavily invested in making sure that they have security with respect to their online information, information that's transferred online by the customers. We have the two big ones, and like you all are saying, it is not something that they can just spend 1 year on, because every time that you put a safety safeguard in, the hackers come with something else. So please know the FSC has got the eyes on that as well, because when we look at it, both the CBB and the FSC, we see this as one financial sector, and the weakest link can cause a systemic risk. The systemic risk of the system will undermine the whole financial system. So please don't think that the credit unions are getting off scot-free. They are held to a similar standard as well. So I knew that one was I can call it a googly, but I took
I'd also help you with that and say that it takes a tremendous amount of capital investment, constant investment to meet certain standards, right? So there may be a way in terms of looking at your controls. Some of the controls may have to be physical controls, because if you wade in as hard as, you know, across the board, then you could threaten some businesses, right? Because the amount, just the investment demands would be so significant. I think that's one of the things that has slowed down the growth of digital in our part of the world, because it's not, like I said, you're dealing with Nimitz class aircraft carriers in some cases, as opposed to jet skis. And you know, the ability to move, the cost of moving such a big vehicle is so immense. And the credit unions are huge, right? They have huge memberships, but again, I can't speak to the financials, but the amount of investment required for them to meet these very stringent standards is going to be significant. So it's a partnership you'd have to have with them to help ensure the right level of controls are in place, which balances out financially.
Yes. I have another question here, and it says, I find many customers generally are increasingly looking for more ease, speed, convenience, although resistance tends to be widely echoed. That being said, have you all found much resistance or rejection of technological revolutions by executive and management within the financial institutions themselves? How have the executives been? Do you find they welcome it, or have you had resistance there? Paul?
No, definitely no resistance at all senior levels, at my shareholder levels. There are active programs, digital transformation programs going on now. So rather than it being resistance, it's actually a target to achieve digital transformation. So definitely an activity that they're on board with.
And I would say that my mere existence at First Caribbean is me, I'm the digital guy. So I you know, that kind of says the focus and the drive by top executive management and the shareholders in moving things towards technological innovation in a way that is meaningful towards giving customers the best possible experience and making them as secure as possible.
Colin, what has been your experience with your clients that you deal with?
In terms of my clients, the clients are particularly happy to do stuff digitally. It cuts down the amount of time they're on the road. It cuts down on the ability, on the frustration of having to wait in line. But then when I look at other components of my customer base, there's still an insistence when it comes to my time of meeting physically. So there's still that side of resistance when I look at it from my practice side, that there's still a lot of customers who want to have in-face meetings. And to a certain extent, I don't mind, because working from home can be challenging. It can be a very lonely experience. So we have to get that balance between the traditional and the digital.
Well, Cyralene, I'd like to comment on that, because I actually feel the next disruption is not going to be technology the way we think it is. The next disruption is actually clients having the desire to see somebody. I mean, sometimes it's difficult actually, if you're calling some institutions internationally to hear a person. And I feel the next level, and this actually happened in Canada a couple of years back, where when there was this big push to get people out of the bank, then when business suffered, there was a big desire to actually get face to face with people. So we're going to go do a full circle on this. We're going to get as digital as possible, but the next disruption is going to be, how can I see my customer?
And Paul, having said that, you could already tell that we can cater to that so that we don't have to go through it, you know, where we make sure we have the right balance. Yes, especially as you allude to, we do have the seniors, etc. Maybe we don't need to push them all, and even George alluded to that. We don't have to push them all to digital. We can have a combination of where we use technology, but still remember customer service still is about the customer and meeting their needs and meeting them, as George said, I remembered it, where they are at. I have another quick one here. This is the one, and this is someone who's looking for help here. Given that data breaches and hacking are rampant in modern day, what do you think are some methods that the common people can use to protect their data? I know this person is getting a free consultation here. George, do you want to take that one? What can the average person do just to protect their own data?
So obviously, as long as you're online, you want to have antivirus software running on an up-to-date subscription of antivirus software running on all your devices, not just your desktop, your laptop, your phones, your tablets, and so on. Again, it is also habits and hygiene. You know, if you see emails, I mean, when I receive emails from people, I have never received them, even if they look like businesses. I automatically send them for vetting, right? I do not respond to emails. And that was not always so, but in the past 3, 4, 5 years, where you know that people infiltrate your friends and your business partners' accounts, it's possible, right? And business accounts, you know, when you see an email, so it's cautious, it's looking left and looking right. It's don't talk to strangers, the things we were trained on, but translated into the digital form. So part of it is technological, having the antivirus. And I mean, if you're a little more sophisticated or knowledgeable, let's say you can have your own personal firewalls and, you know, things like you don't use basic passwords, you change the standard password on your modem and those kinds of things, right? You don't make it easy for people to gain access to you or your devices. And also, I think you have to be careful on what you put out on social media. I think, you know, people really enjoy posting and discussing and talking about their lives and so on, but just know that there's an algorithm out there capturing that data and analyzing you over time and understanding you, and then there are humans behind that algorithm that are going to take decisions on what to do, and all of those people are not good actors. Some of them are bad actors, so you just have to be very mindful. And if you want to take the risk, right? But then on the other side is like, what happens, right?
And I like how you've put it in a real thing. Don't talk to strangers. And I see Paul is smiling because Paul probably knows of my personal history where I suffered loss because I did talk to a stranger. And these things are real. These things are real with respect to persons mimicking email addresses. They mimic things, and sometimes they have hacked you for so long a period of time that they know how you correspond, and it's very easy for them to mimic you to other persons, and they call it identity theft, and it's very easy to do. But here's another question here, and I'm going to engage on this one. It says, securities and investments in the financial industry seems to be only for institutions or wealthy clients. Outside of loans, savings accounts, and insurance, the silence is deafening. The financial industry can be a catalyst for growth, but it needs to become more inclusive. What are your views on that? And I'm going to say, Colin, I'm going to take your views on that, and then I'm going to go around to the others. That the industry needs to be a catalyst for growth, and it needs to become more inclusive. And what are the plans you think we should have for that?
Yeah, one of the challenges in the securities industries in Barbados, as you well know, Cyralene, is the lack of available product. When I say available product, it means things like corporate bonds on the market. It means things like corporate securities on the market. It means to have an active BSC. It means that companies like SigniaGlobe listing on the securities exchange. It means a lot more private placement type transactions, but you cannot create an investment market if there's no investments on the market. No one is selling their securities to raise capital. So we are much more of a chicken and egg situation than the ability to buy securities in the local market. If you want to buy, if you want to go outside the local market, then, as I said earlier, then we need to have the central bank get to a position where we can freely open accounts in the US or the Canadian market. But without access to capacity, and our issue in Barbados is a capacity issue, we are not going to go a long way. It would be good, I think, Paul, was it you that mentioned it or someone earlier this week? Sorry, it was Roger Cave talking about the Barbados government's ability to come back into the debt market next year and to be able to provide debt securities. But if you're not, if we don't have anything being issued, it is very difficult to have a securities market. I think certainly you might be familiar with the Enterprise Growth Fund Act. Enterprise Growth Fund itself is a has a venture capital component of it, and they're in a position to take funds in as in from venture capital investors. People want to put money into a venture capital firm to take some risks. But EGLF has never made a call for capital in that regard. Okay. So, we can turn an institution like the, and as we know, Enterprise Growth Fund and the other firm, I'm just thinking out loud, that came out of the BDB. BDB was actually one of the largest issuers of debt securities in Barbados, along with the National Housing Corporation. But we have taken a position where the only institution in the Barbados government that issues securities is no central government. So,
well, I'm going to invite Paul to come in here because I think this is a good segue for him as well. Thanks, Colin.
Yes, so this is a business line of ours at SigniaGlobe, and this has been a challenged business line for a number of years now. So over the last, 5 years, we've survived in this business on some significant one-off transactions. They worked well, they made the business look good. But the reality, if you look at the trending of it, lots of companies have been delisting. And they're probably, I had a paper done recently because we're evaluating this business right now to see, you know, how do we go forward with it? And there are probably maybe 5 or 6 active companies there who potentially have shares for listing, for trading. And, I think we need to sit with the BSE and talk about how we can. There was a lot of conversation about a junior market, but we've not seen that come off the ground. Jamaica obviously is a successful case study on this. They have an active junior market. Just listen to the news at night. If you do, and you will hear how many trades they're having compared to how many we are having in our exchange. So there needs to be a complete mindset shift for Barbadians on how the security market works. People generally, when they have a business, they run it on their own. They don't necessarily want to have equity in it. So this is going to take a monumental shift in thinking about how you finance businesses. And how the stock exchange can work for that. And I think we're very, very far from it. And I absolutely do not know right now the solution to how we can get on track. But we're actually in a downward spiral as far as the stock exchange is concerned right now.
Okay. And I have 4 more questions here. I see we're almost out of time, but I want to make sure that I can pose them to you. Here's another one. Can the public expect smooth integration among players in the local and regional, local and regional financial sector, banks, credit unions, insurance companies, brokerage companies? Also, what would it take to see better global e-commerce facilities and opportunities available for persons locally and regionally? Yes, so the question is, do we expect to have integration regionally among our financial institutions? And are they going to, do you think there are going to be more e-commerce opportunities regionally? So this person is saying, let's go outside of Barbados, because if we're speaking of a lack of investment opportunities and products, the question is posed then, should we not be going regionally and try to have a more integrated financial sector?
Well, from my perspective, right now we operate in Barbados alone, but we actually have active plans to reach across the region. So that's a strategic objective of ours. And naturally, so one of our shareholders, Grace Kelly, that's Jamaica. We have Cape Shepherd local and Massey United Trinidad. So, I mean, we essentially are regional already, but our footprint from a SigniaGlobe perspective is not as yet, and we're on that trajectory. And I think it's important. I think it's important for us to leverage a larger market base. I mean, Barbados is very small. And so if you want to get scale, you need to leverage a wider space. And I think that's on the cards for us. Clearly, from a perspective of George, they're already there. So they're having a different type of conversation to the one that I'll be having on this question.
And whilst George is nodding, I'm going to say that we are seeing in the insurance space, definitely, we are seeing a greater integration regionally, because most of the insurance companies, as you would know, already have a footprint within the region and beyond. And we're seeing that with some more amalgamations and joint ventures. Here's another question for you, because we can't keep George silent for too long. What are the major factors that have been prohibiting technological progress? And what can be done to address these concerns for the players at every scale? We spoke already about culture. We spoke about mindset. We spoke that there was a need for education and awareness. Is there anything else that you think that would have been retarding our progress and the uptake of technology in the financial sector?
So you're saying would have been, because the retardation is not there today. And again, as we said earlier, the pandemic has pretty much taken the blinkers off, and we are charging down the road. I would say, and I mean, I don't know how many of you watch Vikings on Netflix, but Ragnar Lothbrok said, you know, forward, don't look back. So that's me. I'm looking forward. But if I were to look in the rearview mirror, I would say that there was a time when the demand, even though the demand was more of a silent demand, again, the customer drives it. It would have been a general awareness that these things are there and they're out there, but the demand, it was more of a passive demand than an active demand, right? And I think that is it. The forces are there. Necessity is the mother of invention. So that's why everybody is digitizing today. And those aren't digitizing are struggling to find a way to, because it is not cheap and it is not easy. It is actually quite painful to digitize as an organization, right? There's much tribulation that you have to go through to reorient yourself, and a lot of cost to go on that digitization path. So, but I would say that there are no governors, there are governors, but there are no things blocking digitization today, because it's a necessity.
And I think I should add here that for us as regulators, even at the FSC, that's our big thrust too, because if you leave it in the regulators behind, if we are not in sync with that, then it means that there's one part of the chain that is still weak. And we ourselves have realized that the massive amount you've got to invest in your infrastructure if you want to digitalize. And that is one of our, like Paul, that is something that is high on our agenda, even that our board is driving that.
I just want to make there is in one of my meetings with a regional regulator, we were talking about the cloud, and they said, look, we are there as well. You know, we understand the risk, but it's something that we have to do. It's not an if and but or maybe. It is for growth, and it's a recognition that, you know, when you think security and the cloud. These cloud companies are trillion-dollar companies, and they spend billions in investment in improvements and in research and development constantly. So the level of security that they have, provided we don't get lax and provided we have the right standards as we use them, you know, is we can't replicate that.
I think this the story that about BlackBerry tells you about cybersecurity, because you remember they were failing as a telephone company, a mobile company, having been overtaken by Samsung, but they segue and have gone into cybersecurity and are even so much more profitable than they ever were when they provided the mobile phones. So they recognize that this is where it's at, and security is one of the things that is.
And they were always the most secure. They always were and still are the most secure phone that you had over there.
Don't tell anyone, but I still have mine on top of my refrigerator.
The volcano, the ash killed mine 3-4 weeks ago, so I finally got home.
All right. Here's this one. I have two more questions. We're segueing slightly different, but this goes back to what persons are concerned about when it comes to Barbados and or being blacklisted, because the financial sector is one of those the areas that are most impacted by that. They said, do you really think that the international assessors accept our local nuances and that they're justified? They said, it does not appear that they do. It appears that they set us criteria, and unless we meet them fully, then we are blacklisted. Maybe I can answer that one as best position to. They do accept our arguments, but often we have to make sure they're evidence-based and that we have the data. It takes a lot in order to persuade them. And sometimes when we don't have the statistics, very often what happens, and I will say this for most of our financial institutions, I'm going to put a plea in now, that when you're asked to do your filings on a timely basis, and a lot of questionnaires comes from regulators, it's because that's the data that we are collecting, almost sometimes it seems yearly, in order that we can have it presented to the assessors. But you will see that from time to time, the government, the Attorney General does announce that we have been upgraded, meaning that our arguments have been accepted and we are seen to be better positioned or more in compliance with the international best standards. So they do take on most of our arguments and they do accept them. Yes, I have one last question in the chat here, and this is both to Colin and George. Okay, I think I answered that. You answered that in a way. Somebody did ask you, how do we change culture? I think you said it was it's a gradual process. It needs to be phased, needs to be education and awareness. Now we're almost out of time because I have taken some time from our panelists. I know you volunteered to give me 10, or I volunteered you to give me 10 extra minutes. And I wanted to ask you if there was any final comment or point that you wanted to make, that you want to share with our domestic financial institutions and our public with respect to technology and with respect to it improving customer service. And I'm going to start with Colin because he's been quiet for a little too long and it gets me quite worried.
Thank you, Cyralene. I'm just going to share with George and Paul some of the comments I've received over the last few weeks from clients and colleagues in terms of electronic banking rollout and particularly the Visa and debit cards. We're moving in a situation where there's an investment from the banks to digitize, to lower their costs, but that cost lowering is not being seen in the marketplace to the customer. We need to get to the point where the customer gets the benefit of the lower costs accruing to the banks. Okay, and then particularly the other comment, which is really pressing and that has to be answered by the banking community, is seems to be a restriction on the ability to run Visa debit cards as debit transactions, and the customers, vendors are incurring commissions on the Visa transactions. They're not providing credit to the customers. This is an issue that needs to be solved and needs to be solved now.
I'll call you stumped me there because I never knew what you to give me two statements and then thing. But the last one is an interesting one, and you're saying that their cards, customers are saying that they have cards that don't have any credit facilities to them, but they're not, but they're being charged higher commissions when they go to the portals.
Right, it is the vendors, the guys who are using the vendor terminals. Some of them are saying they can no longer run a Visa debit transaction as a debit transaction, and okay, they're incurring the 3% and 4% commissions on doing the transaction rather than the normal 15 or 25 cents charge to accept the payment. And this is a problem that needs to be solved now.
All right, thank you for sharing that. Paul, I see you wanted to say something. Any final thoughts?
Well, a lot of what Colin just raised, I do have some of those issues as a customer of the bank as well. So I'd be happy to hear. I'm not sure if this is George's domain necessarily, but it is a legitimate concern that clients have, and I do have that concern. But just in final comments, like, this train has left and everybody, you can't avoid but get on it at this point in time. The technology is well on its way. We've been talking a lot in this conversation about the AI, well, in some regard about AI and assessing of behavior and responding to behaviors of clients. But guess what? It's going to go beyond that because it's going to get to the biochemical. So we're going to be looking at our phones as we do now, and they have face recognition. They're going to know where blood pressure is and so on. And decisions are going to be made far more, even faster and quicker than we as human beings could make it. So we have to get on the train, whoever you are in business. I think it will redound, though, initially to the benefit of both the customer and the organization. You'll be able to bring down costs, have efficiencies. Hopefully your people will benefit because they'll have a better balance of life and work, eventually what you would want, maybe. And then the customer hopefully gets a better cost and a faster turnaround. So I think there's a win-win to continue to pursue the technology in all its various forms. And from a banking perspective, I just think we need to get the regulatory, so we can manage our risk and control better as we go through the process. But the train has left, and we just all need to get on board.
Thank you, Paul. And George, any final thought?
And just echoing what Paul said, there's so many developments that are coming over the next 24 months, and even looking at beyond. I mean, I have a 3-year-old son, and I don't know whether he'll ever learn how to drive, because by the time he's of age, self-driving cars will be here. I expect, if I really look forward into the future, you'll be seeing Aruba, that there are no checks, the checklist, cardless, full digital, and Uber society, where we call up a car, we don't own cars, we call up a car and it turns up and it just takes us where we're going, and so on. I mean, looking 15, 20, years down the road, and financial services companies, are going to change. I mean, I see a convergence in all customer facing companies. If we just at the behaviors of Amazon and so on. But what we need to do is keep progressing forward, because the Amazons and the Googles, they're all coming. And as financial institutions and consumer facing institutions, we need to be aware of that. And we progress. Cybersecurity wise, the behavior is the biggest thing for me, because I know what I know. And I just encourage people to be very aware of safeguarding, taking responsibility for your information, not just your personal, your PII, as they call it, your name and address, date of birth, and so on, but your thoughts, your behaviors. Be very aware, because everything is tracked and trackable, analyzable, and then there are counter moves that can be made. And for me, that is the scariest part of all. Outside of the business, the digital part doesn't scare me. The part is the open sharing of ideas and behaviors that can be aggregated and used in ways that are non-beneficial. That to me is something I would like to make everybody aware of.
Ladies and gentlemen, I know you will join me in thanking not just George, but we also thank Colin, and we thank you, Paul. And I hear you constantly underscoring two main things. One, that there's no going back right now, that this is an opportunity for us to leapfrog and make sure that the financial sector even benefit greater, and our customers, from the technological advances. Digitalization is here. We have to be very careful with the information we put out there, because it can be mined and used for purposes we did not intend it to be. But we're saying with all of this, we're looking, as Colin underscored, for costs. We're looking to see if banks and other financial institutions, insurance companies, couldn't pass the cost benefits down to customers. You also want to make sure that the regulators are on board, and together we come and change the culture, because we're hopeful that the national ID is here and it will make things even more seamless, because there'll be consolidated information, centralized and accurate. And with the cyber security in place, then the future looks good for us in this airspace. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you to our panelists. I want to encourage you now to make sure you do go and complete the poll for us. It's important that we get feedback as we host these sessions to make sure that we're delivering on concepts and ideas and issues that you want to hear about. In addition, I want to let you know that because we recorded a session, it will be posted on the Central Bank's website and social media pages. And we also want to encourage you that on June the 3rd at 8 p.m., There will be the Caribbean Economic Forum hosted by the Central Bank of Barbados. And the topic for that forum is putting people at the center of development in the Caribbean. Putting people at the center of development in the Caribbean. And the event will be live streamed on the bank's website, on its Facebook page and YouTube channel. And we would like you to join us then. For me as moderator, and on behalf of all the team at the Central Bank and the Financial Services Commission, thank you for joining us for the Domestic Financial Institutions Conference, and may you have a blessed day and stay online and stay safe in the cyber world. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye. Thank you, George. Thank you, Paul. Cheers. Thank you, Colin.
Paul, you good?
Hi, Koma, you all right?
I'm peaceful. All right.